So perfect. So then we can start. A warm welcome from our side to our lecture series, Digital Sustainability Transformation of, by, and for the TUM. We are very happy to start today with our first session when we go into the into the topics. And we will have today a very a session that is not only we had in the semester before also sessions that are very much theoretical sessions, but today we have a very practical session because we want to look into how to calculate the carbon footprint of our digital services and devices. And I think this is really a topic of crucial importance for all of us. And so we are very, very happy that Jens Gröger is today with us, our guest, a real expert in this topic. He's a senior researcher at the Institute for Applied Ecology in Berlin, and an expert in sustainable product and material flows. And he is very much in this topic. He focuses in his work on sustainable consumption of products, especially in the areas of information and communication technologies regarding the question of digital transformation. He's looking into, for example, life cycle assessment of ICT products, the development of award criteria for eco labels, like, for example, the Blue Angel, the definition of minimum requirements for green public procurement, and new assessment methods for different sources and institutions that are linked to question of sustainable information and communication technologies, for example, how to make data centers, telecommunication networks more efficient. For example, one of his current projects is on greening cloud computing. And so he's really an expert in these topics, and he will give us an insight into it and also demonstrate us how to calculate our personal carbon footprint over our digital lifestyle when using, for example, video streaming, video conferencing, or other digital devices. So I think this is really has a very clear practical relevance today. And obviously we are all familiar with that, especially in this corona and hopefully sometime post-corona period, this question is becoming even more relevant. So we are very happy that you're today with us. We proceed as follows. We have in this first part, you give a presentation. You can already see the slides here. And this is a webinar. So for you, after this presentation, we will have here a question answer round. And you have a button here. You can post your questions and then we will discuss them here. And after this part, we will then switch over, leaving this webinar and going to a Zoom meeting. And then it goes really into this practical question of how to measure the individual carbon footprint. So you're invited now to be here and then later to join the workshop. But I've talked a lot. I will now hand over to you. Thank you again for being here and sharing your thoughts with us. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Stefan Woster, for this introduction. Telling that I'm a real great expert in that field. Thank you very much for that. And in fact, I've been working 12 years at Institute doing assessment for sustainability of products. And finally, I ended up at this digital products. One reason is because I'm myself a telecommunication electronician. I did this as a practical apprenticeship. And so I came back to the roots of these telecom networks, data centers, and all that stuff. I will present one little outcome of our research, which is the calculation of the individual carbon footprint of digital services or of digital lifestyles. And my initial slide already shows the intensive use of digital devices and so on, which end up in 1 ton of carbon emissions per year. Which is quite a huge number, especially we are not really aware that digital services produce this much carbon emissions. And in fact, I'll show you where they do produce these carbon emissions and how we did calculate that. And then, I'll show the planned agenda. This is I make in the first half an hour an introduction into the methodology, how we do calculate. Then there is an interactive part where you can calculate yourself. There is an online CO2 calculator where you just can push around different units and see what happens. We prepared already some questions that you can investigate during playing around with that tool. And then we have a third session feedback from the tests and discussion, what you've learned from using that tool, especially in terms of what are the conclusions for maybe policy measures, how to reduce carbon emissions from digital services and from the digital habits in general. So we did this assessment for a client for the BUND, which means Bund für Umwelt und Naturschutz, and the English title is in fact Friends of the Earth Germany, which is a non-governmental organization, and they did or they are still doing some campaigns about awareness using your digital devices and so on. And we actually collected already existing data from several fields, from life cycle assessments and from studies we have been doing ourselves. I don't know why that switched right now. Go back to this one. And if you want to look at this report, you'll find these links here. And I think we can post them afterwards, either the slides or the links into the chat here. BUND, they really use that for different campaigns and quizzes and whatever. So what have we done? In general, what is the problem at all, or why it is necessary to get aware about the environmental footprint of digital services? There is a huge rise of electricity usage for data centers. A data center is some kind of factory where lots of computers are stored and they're doing all these calculations. If we make, a Google request, or we upload a photo, or we make a translation in the internet, or doing whatever in the internet, then there will be a data center who processes all this data and stores this data. And this here is a prediction how the energy use of data centers will rise from 2010 to 2030. And there are three different scenarios. The expected case ends up here at 3,000 terawatt hours of electricity. The worst case is about 8,000 terawatt hours, and the best case about 1,000 terawatt hours. These numbers compared to the worldwide electricity which is used right now, it would be in the worst case 28% of the worldwide electricity consumption that is only consumed by data centers worldwide. Yeah, but in the expected case 11%, which is still quite a huge number, especially if we know that everybody wants to have this electricity. We want to turn the steel production electrical, we want to drive the cars electrical, and now still there are these data centers who consume more and more electricity. So there is one problem with the data centers. The second problem is in fact with the networks, so the telecommunication networks. We also see here in these bars a rising energy demand until 2030, up to 30,000 terawatt hours per year, which might be consumed by different technologies. These are the technologies such as the core networks, but also especially the fixed networks, the cable networks, copper cable networks, fiber cable networks, but also the 2G, 3G, 4G, and upcoming 5G, which means fifth generation of telecom units of antennas standing around and broadcasting and so on. So also this is quite a number which is rising. I don't have a number for the private households, but also in private households, we observe that right now, for example, televisions are already consuming as much as refrigerators. We are very happy that we got these flat screens and they get more and more efficient. Efficiency means that they, compared to the diameter of the screen, they consume less energy per centimeter square, but unfortunately they get bigger and bigger. And so right now these televisions really consume as much as refrigerators, which we thought refrigerators were the really consumers in households. This always switches, I don't know why. So we have the scope of this study to estimate the carbon footprint is that we looked at the end user devices. So all these computers, telephones, routers, and so on, but also the modems, which are based at home, and they do have to be produced, but they are also consuming electricity in the use phase. So they have these two items which produce carbon emissions. Then we have the telecommunication networks, fixed and mobile. And then we have the data center. So in fact, it's four different parts that have to be calculated, the production, the use phase of the end user devices, the telecom networks, and the data centers. And this is what we did, or actually in this study, we just collected the data we found somewhere else. For example, for mobile phones, there is this study of different telephones. This is already quite old, from 2016, or these slides maybe even from 2015, where it starts with 17 kilogram carbon emissions for very easy, very light telephone, Sony, and ends up at these iPhone 6, which were the latest models then, which have approximately 100 kilogram of carbon emissions for production. In fact, this slide shows also the emissions in the use phase, but we know there is a link to the memory size of the telephones, because especially the computer part, the microprocessor and the storage in these phones is the main impact for this carbon emissions in the production phase. And this is the reason why there, for example, we estimate that today's telephones will need 100 kilogram of carbon emissions at least. And this is what we took it as one number for each telephone. We don't care about the model then. These are several numbers, end user devices for their production and the electricity consumption in the use phase. So to produce a desktop computer with monitor, for example, you need 435 kilogram of carbon emissions. For a laptop computer, 311, for a monitor, 88 kilogram, and so on. We see also the smartphone with 100 kilogram and the router with 77 kilogram only for the production. But then there is still the power consumption in the operation phase. And maybe to explain to you, I don't know why that always switches here. To explain to you, if you consume electricity, for sure you don't have carbon emissions directly from the plug-in or wherever, but you have carbon emissions at the electric power plant. So if you burn coal or fossil fuels or anything, you will have carbon emissions there, and you really can calculate if you're using 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, for example, you will end up at 400 grams of carbon emissions, for example, approximately. And this, in fact, depends on the country you are in or how the electricity mix looks like. But for Germany, it's the 400 grams per kilowatt hour of electricity. And yeah, this is one thing where you can calculate the carbon emissions directly from the use phase. There are these other stages or the other problems that I already mentioned, the telecommunication networks. And there we did an assessment in another project where we looked at different types of network equipment. And these are the numbers we took for this calculator. For the blue bar, which is an UMTS 4G, UMTS is 3G network, you have 32 watts or 32 watt hours if you transfer 1 gigabyte of data in the time of 1 hour. And this the same number for the fixed network, for the cable network, a VDSL network. And this gives us the possibility to calculate the energy consumption of these respective networks depending on the data volume. So if you transfer data over the networks, then you will use energy. And it depends on if you either transport it over fixed networks or cable networks or over mobile phone networks. It differs in the energy consumption during the transfer. Last point, carbon footprint in data centers itself. And this is in fact quite a complicated task to calculate. And this is one example that we calculated in the same project as I showed before, that we looked how much energy is being consumed in data centers and how many services are delivered by these data centers. And this data center, for example, ended up with 900 tons of carbon emissions, but they delivered 619 million hours of video streaming. It was in fact a television video streaming that they supported. So this gives us the possibility to calculate the carbon footprint of 1 hour of video streaming, which is about 1.5 grams, which is not so much compared to cars or anything else, but still it's a number and an impact. And what we're doing right now, a Zoom conference, also video conferencing has a certain footprint, which is about 2.5 grams in the data center, plus the energies that is being consumed in the transfer network, as I said before, plus the energy that is consumed at your end use device. I don't have, I'll switch back to this one. So what we calculate is the production of the devices plus the carbon emissions from the use phase, plus the carbon emissions from the transfer over the network, plus the carbon emissions, which are related to the data centers. All right. So far, the methodology, and before we step into the interactive part, I would show you the carbon calculator myself in a short introduction. Because afterwards you will go and play around with that tool, and I have to start my browser, I guess, instead of this one, which is like here, and there somewhere should be this calculator. Is that slide right now visible? My browser, is it? Yeah. So great. Yeah. We developed with these numbers and with these calculation ideas this model here. And you will get that link later on, or you can already see the link here. And the idea about this is that you have the possibility to shift around these parts. For example, if I have a smartphone, I can shift it here, I can remove it again. So I can put it here and remove it again. And I can see what happens in for the carbon footprint. If I'm using this part, maybe the smartphone is a bad example. I better take the laptop computer, which is might be more interesting, because I have different things to observe here. This laptop computer leads to 80 kilograms of carbon emissions per year. And if we zoom in here just by tipping on this donut, we see that there is a production part of it. It's 62 kilogram carbon emissions for producing that per year. I will tell you later on why per year. And then there is a use phase of 18 kilograms. So here we can see not all the four parts that I told you, because the use phase is the electricity consumption plus the networks plus the data centers, but we can see the differentiation between production and use phase. And we also can manipulate these numbers by looking at the details. And to look into the details, we can click on the laptop computer here, for example, and we see that in this scenario, we are using one unit of laptop computer. We're using it daily 5 hours. The period of use, so the lifetime of the computer is 5 years. So the effort I had to produce it will be divided by 5 years. This is why I said the production is only 62 kilogram per year, because the total number seems to be 5 times as much as this one, which is divided by 5 years. And after 5 years, I will throw it away. And also the annual energy consumption is linked to the daily usage time, because I showed that in the slide before, there is a energy consumption in the really using this device, but there is also energy consumption in the standby mode. So if I use it 5 hours per day, probably it'll consume 19 hours standby. So we can calculate this yearly or this annual energy consumption. And we can in fact manipulate that. We can press here on this button below, which is a pen somehow. And we can say we don't use it only 5 hours per day, we use it 10 hours. And it should be that the annual energy consumption is approximately double as much as it was before. It's only approximately, because there is also the standby consumption, which gets less than. And also the period of lifetime, if I would use it only 1 year, then the total greenhouse gas emissions that come from the production will end up here in my yearly consumption. And if I'm ready with it, then I'll see that the yearly energy and the yearly carbon emissions is 338 kilogram, which are the production 311 plus the electricity consumption, the use phase, and so on. I mean, these are the different different possibilities that we implemented in this tool. I mean, you could differentiate it much more. You could put any Twitter feed or any uploaded photo there. Additionally, we have only this raw categories, such as how much data are you transferring over the mobile internet. And you can manipulate it by the gigabyte per month that you're transferring. So if you're a very heavy user and you're using it, whatever, 50 gigabyte per month, then you will even see the effects on the carbon emissions in total. My last point is that you can look at what other people are doing by choosing one of these options. You can look at the average digital consumption. This is quite interesting that the average digital consumption, the average internet usage, but also how many hours people are watching TV and so on, ends up approximately 3/4 tons of carbon emissions. The heavy user uses a little bit more, 1 ton, but therefore that it's a heavy user, it's not this much more. The reason why is because this is what you will see, the production of all these parts is the main thing. So it doesn't really matter if you're using your tablet 1 hour or 10 hours per day, it's mainly the production of the tablet, for example, that gives the most impact. Video streaming, we took as one example where there's only TV set router and the streaming service provided by the data center and the network. And also home office is one example, which consists of a monitor, desktop computer, router, printer, and fixed line. So already doing home office is related to approximately 1/4 ton carbon emissions. So, and this is my digital consumption. This is in this case your digital consumption. And maybe Stefan Wurster or Markus Sievert will give you the link that you already see here to the, maybe I can post it already to the chat.
I think it's also already there.
Ah, it's
somebody
already
from
there.
The audience already posted it.
And that's right, and great. Yeah, so I can. I don't have to post it again.
But we will have to switch anyways then to have a more interactive approach.
So I will stop this slide and go back to this one. I can't see because there are too many things. There is this interactive part coming up right now. Here are the actions or the questions or whatever that we have prepared that should be performed by you. These are three questions. And one is, please assess your individual digital carbon footprint. So just try what you can get from this tool, how you can increase the numbers or maybe reduce the numbers, and then identify, in fact, the main impact to have a big carbon footprint. And maybe starting from there, where are the saving potentials? What could be done? I mean, for sure, you could not use any digital services or any digital devices at all. But also inside this 3/4 tons of carbon emissions, there are saving potentials by still using these devices and maybe using them differently. And so my question is, where are the main impacts? And then third question is derivate political options for actions. So what can we see there? And maybe are there any, let's say, recommendations for the politics or how to reduce the carbon, what could we do to improve the situation? And one thing I didn't talk about, because I've been talking about carbon emissions all the time, we have to keep in mind that all these digital devices end up in electrical waste. And they also consume quite a lot of resources, raw materials, rare earths, and so on. And so, it's a good idea to think also about, either the lifetime of these products or, to reduce the overall consumption in general. So this was my input from my side, and so I hand over to our host today. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for this very insightful presentation. And I think all of us, we want now already to start and calculate our footprint. But before we are doing this, we have here some Q&A questions first, and then we switch over. And I will now hand over to Markus Sievert. Sorry, at the beginning, I don't introduce him, but you know him from the last session as well. And we try now to answer these questions here first, and then we switch over to the Zoom meeting.
Yeah, exactly. So the first question directly relates to what you said at the end of your talk. So there was one question regarding whether you also had to look at the emissions of throwing away recycling, so like the end cycle. Is this an idea that you will follow up on? Maybe you can say something on this as well.
In fact, the end of life, we call it, often even leads to not to emissions, but to benefits, because we say there are certain materials that could be recycled, so they reduce the effort for producing more things. So from the life cycle assessment perspective, one word, life cycle assessment is the look on a product from its raw material generation, transport, production, assemble, whatever. It ends up in a shop, then you use it and you throw it away afterwards. You reach the end of life. This is a life cycle, and the life cycle assessment looks at all these steps. And in fact, if you look at raw material consumption or about toxical wastes or problems that that are linked to this product, such as electrical waste, rubbish dumps, which pollute the water and everything, and the people that are working in this recycling sector, then you will find quite different problems as if you only look at the carbon emissions. But we actually in this project looked only to the carbon emissions, but we do other projects where we also look at the, let's say, social problems and the raw material mines and everything.
Yeah, thank you. Another question from the audience was related to how exactly you calculated like the average digital footprint that you mentioned, like the average consumer. How does that prototype look like?
We did some research in user habits, and so, for example, how many hours people are watching TV and how many digital devices are being sold in Germany. We had the focus of Germany, and so you can calculate if these many devices are being sold, then you can calculate how long they're being used and so on. And in fact, this was quite a heavy part to find afterwards these numbers. A telephone is averagely used 2.5 years, for example. But I mean, there are some users that buy every year a new telephone, and other users that are really able to use it 8 or 10 years. Yeah. So the average is always, a little bit estimated, but you can do it.
It's amazing how much research you have to do, kind of like just to calculate these, kind of like one little number in the data.
Looks very easy, in fact.
Yeah. Exactly. Mm. And then last question from the audience: whether that tool only applies to Germany, or whether you also already have something in the pipeline for other countries, or whether you can change that settings.
Yeah. In fact, that tool, this is why the address is TUM, is not yet published yet. So it's an internal tool yet, and we don't know yet how to publish it. So you are, in fact, the lucky ones that can try this tool already. And the difference between Germany and the rest of the world is, in fact, only the electricity mix. So if we have 400 grams for the electricity for 1 kilowatt hour of electrical power, then it's in other countries differently. I know from Poland, for example, they are at 750 grams per kilowatt hour because they have lots of coal power plants there. But if you go to Norway, for example, they have lots of hydropower there. Then these numbers are much lower. So I think we would make a European tool. One interesting thing in France, the numbers also get quite better because they have nuclear power plants. And so maybe also their carbon emissions might not be the right indicator. Maybe it should be nuclear waste then that should be detected with this tool.
And maybe I can add 1.5 last questions. What I found interesting that you mentioned, kind of like in the comparison of CO2 emissions, kind of like how should we compare our uses of a digital device that we use on a daily basis, like a cell phone, a mobile phone, to is it driving car or is it traveling or what it, you know, what is the best comparison here that triggers reactions?
Yeah, it's in fact not the car. For example, for the video streaming, we realized it's only 1.5 gram per hour. And I think this is to drive 30 meters with a car, with an average car. So everybody would say, don't care. I mean, it's right that cars, for example, have a much bigger environmental impact than using digital devices. And this is the reason why it's in fact, if you compare some traveling to a workshop or to a conference and so on, you always end up that the digital solution is the better one because it really uses less. But what we can observe, just the same thing as the rising televisions getting huger televisions, is that people these days don't meet each other or write text message or anything. They do mobile video calls. And I mean, mobile video calls do in fact transport much more data over the network and consume energy in the network than just writing text messages or talking verbally to someone else. So it's not really fair to compare it with a business travel by plane to a conference or anything, because video conferencing ended up at a daily use. So you're sitting in the same room, but you're doing a video conference and you have in fact additional consumption. And as we saw from the consumption that come from the mobile networks, also there is a huge rise of electricity consumption expected for future times. And we transport more and more data with all this Internet of Things, that we have sensors everywhere and we see if somebody's sitting on the chair or isn't, and we transport all this data over the network. So we are in fact producing huge amounts of data, which lead to huge amounts of electricity consumption.
It is one message in the chat saying like 900, more than 900,000 Zoom meetings at Toom in the last 12 months. Mm. I probably participated like in 100,000 or so, probably. So it felt like, yeah, like it. So if there are no more questions now, then we would stop this session and invite all the others. I have the numbers. So we have almost, I see how many are out there. So I expect all of you to switch over to the other Zoom meeting. You find the link in the chat, you find the link on Moodle, you find the link at our website. So there's no reason for not joining us now. We have another 45 minutes so that we then can really play around with this awesome tool have an exchange and talk about what our footprint actually is and what we can do about it.
We just have one last question here in the chat. It just appears. Maybe you can answer this one here, and then we switch over. It is because of this topic with driving. But the question is now: what do you think about the idea of self-driving cars and the data that is generated there with regard to emissions? Will this reduce, the emissions here, or what is your
One funny idea about self-driving car is that if you don't find a parking space, you just have it running around while you're at the dentist, and you just step into the car after 1 hour if you leave the dentist. So that probably will not help to reduce carbon emissions. And the other thing is, in fact, for self-driving cars, we're producing very lots of data that have to be transported very quickly. So we have to extend all our telecommunication networks. That might have a positive effect, but it has in the first step a effect that we need more infrastructure and more electricity. And so it's more or less the idea that you really include these sustainability questions in any development of new technologies. So also if you develop artificial intelligence algorithms or whatever, that might be fine, that might be helpful, but you have to be aware that there is additional consumption and you have to improve your systems already while you're developing them. And so there will be an effect, and it's a bad idea just to ignore these effects. It's a better idea to include them already in the development process.
Okay, thank you very much. We can discuss also these points further, but yes. We want to change now. So we stop this here.